Sneakers and Cleats, the podcast. Welcome back to the Sneakers and Cleats podcast. It is Wednesday, September 27th. This is our 30th episode, a very nice number for the me as a Broncos fan.
Yeah, oh yeah.
We'll get to that in 1 second.
Well, this is our Inver Broncos.
Yeah.
No defense.
No D. Yeah, I went off on them on Monday. We're not, you know, we're gonna relax.
No more rehash.
No, yeah, I'm on to next week. We're on to Chicago.
On to the Bears.
So this is our High School Hype Squad episode of the podcast. We are highlighting two local teams. They're playing on Thursday night, Brennan and O'Connor. As always, I'm Matt Roy, joined by Zack Hedrick, our other high school fanatic here between the two of us. So this is episode 30. Obviously, Terrell Davis is going to come to mind, even though he might not be the most prominent as of late. But TD, always going to come to mind for me as a Bronco fan.
Yeah. For me, you know, 30, it starts and ends with Steph.
It's so, kind of the whole Curry family, too, because like I think Dell wore it at some point, and then I think Seth wore it at Duke, right?
Yeah, so, you know, that's a good number for the Curry family, so obviously it worked out. And strangely enough, there's a lot of NHL goalies that go with 30, so that's the goalie number, I guess. So
I mean, I didn't know that, actually.
Martin Brodeur, Lundqvist.
That's a good one.
So...
Yeah, I did.
I don't recall Ed Balfour wearing 30 for the Stars. I think he wore another number, but apparently he wore 32 at some point in his career. So
things we're learning today, Zack Hedrick, big hockey goalie guy. So
Ed Balfour. That's the extent of my knowledge. Ed Balfour, because he was on the Stars.
That's fair.
Way back in the day, last time they hoisted the Stanley Cup.
That's fair. Well, Terrell Davis, obviously a Super Bowl MVP, 2,000-yard rusher. Career ended much too soon with all of his knee injuries after this two Super Bowl seasons. But without him, the Broncos wouldn't have won two Super Bowls. So whenever I think 30, I think him. I also think of Philip Lindsay just because TD had to give up his number for Philip Lindsay. he didn't have to. He allowed him to give up his number. But Steph Curry, top 4 point guard of all time?
Yeah. He's...
4. I think 4 is pretty easy. That's like being really generous with
it. It's the Mount Rushmore. I mean, obviously, best three-point shooter in the game. So
ever, yeah.
So that, you know, nobody can take away that title from him. When you get into, like, is he a point guard? Is he a shooting guard? That's when the debates happen, because I know what it was a couple weeks ago. Everybody was talking like, oh, him or Magic, you know, and, you know.
They play different games.
All the old hats, are going Magic, because it's just kind of like the dude actually was a point guard. Like, right. Yeah, he scored, but he also facilitated. Steph, yeah, he's maybe facilitating more now that he's getting older, but it's like, what do you think of when you say the name Curry? It's crazy three-pointers, half-court shots, full-court shots. You know, that's the Curry game.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to go down. He still has years left, so he's probably going to go down as 1 or 2 in point guard rankings, and he's probably going to go down as a top 15 player of all time to be safe about it. But love doing that at the beginning of the pod. This week, we're going to recap very interesting week 5 in high school football. A little light. Teams on their bye week, and a kind of a light week 6 we got in front of us. A lot of the TNL top 10 on bye week, so this might be a little quicker than usual. But talk surprises, main takeaways from week 5. We're going to go over our TNL top 10 for 5A, 6A, our sub top 10 for 1A through 4A. And we got our preview of the TNL matchup, Brennan Bears, O'Connor Panthers, coming at you tomorrow night from Ferris Stadium. So get to hear from a couple of coaches. We got Coach Baser, Coach Molesky, two longtime Northsiders.
Yeah.
So get to hear from them. I just talked to them about 30 minutes ago. So, Zack, week 5, we are halfway. We're week 6 now, halfway through regular season. Any thoughts on the season as a whole so far that are sticking out to you?
Just how quickly it's going right. By. I mean, it's like, my gosh, we're at 6 already. And, you know, as mentioned, it's a lighter week because all the teams are kind of getting their bye week on before the final, you know, push here to the playoffs. No real surprises for me in week 5. I can't really – I mean, Soto, I think, is the biggest team just, you know, year to year. Seeing, you know, first year of varsity football, obviously tough, but then to see them grow up, Juan Morales, you can't say enough of the job that he's done. Also, I think Kerrville Tyvee's been a little bit of a surprise, too. They're in our you know, top 10. They're undefeated. Beat Bastrop last week. You know, they beat Liberty Hill too. Yep. So it's like, I think Bastrop is their game maybe this week. That might have been where I got crossed up. But
yep, they're playing Bastrop Friday.
So they beat Liberty Hill this past week, which mm-hmm. you know is always they've been you know a deep playoff team. The past few seasons and everything. So Kerrville Tyvee, I think, also a surprise. Sotomayor and Kerrville Tyvee, those two. Top five, it's been unchanged, so it's just kind of like, you know, everything's kind of been going to chalk for those guys. They keep on rolling and looking great. You know, gosh, Ty Hawkins, just he's looking like a cheat code. So
yeah, I mean, Tyvee of Johnny Manziel fame up there in Kerrville. The Antlers having a great season so far. We usually don't talk about them just because, like, they're so far out. We don't really get to see them very often. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, hell of a season so far for them. I think they won by 6 over Liberty Hill. Liberty mm-hmm. Hill having a down year because they've lost a lot of games, especially to our local teams this year.
Wagner, you know, had them, what, in week one or two or something? You know, so that's a big feather in the cap for the Wagner T-Birds as well. So.
And then Liberty Hill went out and scored 82-83 or something like that.
It was a video game.
Yeah, they were doing their best Miami Dolphins impression. I said I wasn't going to talk about that today. So far, week five, looking at it, yeah, you're right on Sotomayor. I think it's 164-7 through their first four games. I don't know if that's good or bad, but maybe they could give the Broncos some lessons on defense because that's pretty freaking good.
It is good. Now it's gut check time for the Wildcats because now they're going to get into the teeth of their schedule. They've set themselves up well to be in the mix in that district and possibly get a playoff berth here. If they can, you know, sneak out some wins here in these final 4 weeks, you know, hey, look at that. You know, what a turnaround from just one win to being a playoff team. That's going to be impressive.
If I had one surprise, and surprise is kind of probably overstating it because it's not really like too much of a surprise if you really know these districts, is how competitive that Northside district really is this year. You have Jay, who's 4-0, Soto. No, they're 5-0.
Jay's 5-0.
Jay 5-0, thank you. Soto, 4-0, 2-0 in district. You have Harlan, who is just looks like world beaters right now at 5-0, already beat Brennan. You already have Brennan. You still have Brennan, who's really good. Not Taft, sorry. But you have such a good district and so many deep teams in that district that I was a little like I talked about it with both coaches. Every week is just a dogfight mm-hmm. in that district. So it's kind of crazy to see how many good teams there are.
You touched on it. It's that district is a lot like the NFL. There are no weeks off. Mm-hmm. It may look like, oh, yeah, we can maybe chalk that one up to, you know, a winnable game, right? But as we saw with the Dallas Cowboys last week, it may appear as a winnable game, but, you know, somebody could come out. The ball bounces their way, or you know, they just come out and play fired up. That can happen with any matchup in that district. So that's always a fun one to watch.
I mean, Stevens can be looked at as something that's maybe not an easy win, but maybe something that you'll look at your schedule and say, "Oh, we should be able to win that game." But then they gave Jay all they could handle this week, and Jay's one of the top teams in the district.
Stevens, you know, they lost. You know, they're having some turnover because KK Brashears, you know, their 4-year guy at quarterback, you know, obviously graduating, but. You know, yet now it's a young Falcons team, but they're finding their way too of just trying. Okay, who are our guys that we move forward with? So, as you mentioned, they gave everything they could.
Yeah,
and they've scored a lot of points in some games too. So they're going to be an interesting one to watch.
Exactly, like even O'Connor, who's 0-5, almost beat Brandeis week one, and then you have Holmes, who almost beat Stevens by only lost by 8. They can score with the best of them. So you just have so many teams in that district who. Bring it week every single week, and mm-hmm. it's never an easy matchup. Another surprise for me, at least, was usually that SAISD district with Alamo Heights in it is Alamo Heights, and then everybody else. But this year, I mean, McCollum, Burbank, both of them having extraordinary years. I mean, McCollum beating Lanier. I mean, they were up by a lot of points, and then ended up only winning by 7 against Lanier. Lanier putting on a good show there for the Vokes.
Yep,
but. That district also more competitive than I was expecting.
Yeah, it'll be fun to see that McCollum Burbank game when that happens, or you know, when it does. Kevin Hernandez for the Bulldogs really played. You know, it kind of I think opened some eyes for people. Maybe that was the first time that they got to see them.
Yep.
But he's a playmaker, and yeah, you know they kind of were in there with Alamo Heights just maybe for the first half, and then, you know, Colin Ernst did his thing, and the Mules kind of ran away with it there in the second half.
Pun intended.
Yeah, but, you know, the Bulldogs, they've got a lot of experience now, so they're gonna be a pretty solid team, and you know, again, playoff matchups, you know, because it's like the runner up plays, you know, the third or fourth, you know, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. We're not there yet, but you know, they're gonna be a fun team to watch, you know, here in the last few weeks as well.
Yeah, Burbank and McCollum are just like, they're a good second tier in that division. Obviously, Alamo Heights is the cream of the crop when it comes to that district, but Burbank, McCollum, both very good teams that mm-hmm. could win a playoff game if it comes down to it.
Yeah.
So the other surprise, just for week five in general, that Madison and Brandeis game
was phenomenal.
24-21, Madison wins in OT. Brandeis got out to a 21-7 lead, didn't score the rest of the game. Madison scores 17 unanswered. And then capped off by Aiden Page, the 32-yard field goal in overtime. So hell of a win for the Fighting Chuck Mikitinics, Fighting Madison Mavericks.
And a game Madison really needed to have just because, you know, they were starting out 0-2 in district, and that win kind of keeps them in it a little bit. You know, if they can pick up two more here or there, they're right in the mix and are in contention still for playoff spots. But yeah, without Landon Gill too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hopefully he's you know, getting back healthy and can, you know, help them make a push here. But what a job by their quarterback. The first name escapes me, but Hickman, I believe.
Yeah, Blake, I think.
Yeah, so just a fantastic job by him. Jordan Clay, two big, you know, they hooked a couple times, one an 80-yarder. Preceding that Aiden Page field goal, so
might have been an inadvertent whistle on that one. I don't know. I don't know what happened, but it was like an 80-yarder where somebody, the DB stopped playing.
I think he might have saw the flag being thrown, and you know, it's like, is it a dead play?
Right, and then he runs into the end zone.
So, but yeah, what a game between them. You know, Madison is right in the thick of it.
Yeah, and having Madison like. Coming off of that loss a couple of weeks ago to Churchill, which was 1 point in overtime that got delayed, and then you lose that game and you have to come back and you have to try and kind of claw yourself back into your district. And to beat Brandeis, who week one looked like world beaters with Lincoln Filiaw throwing for five touchdowns, Lincoln Filiaw, very good quarterback over Brandeis, to win that game and kind of dig yourself out of the hole, it was pretty awesome to see for Madison.
Yeah, it has been a weird week. You mentioned a game that started Friday, Saturday, whatever it was,
Saturday,
and then ended on Monday, you know, and then you come back the next Saturday, you're playing undefeated Roosevelt, you know, that's good. They lost a close game there, it was 28-24. So yeah, it, you know, big intestinal fortitude shown by the Madison Mavericks to win that ball game.
Exactly.
So they'll be an interesting one to watch.
Yeah, let's get to the TNL top 10 for week five. So Reagan, obviously they are number one still. They beat Marshall 43-0. I believe they're 4-0, 2-0 in district. Brad Jackson, their quarterback, had four touchdowns, 189 yards. Cole Pryor, two more touchdowns, a little under 100 yards. I think he had 91 yards on seven carries. I don't know. I'm not really great at math, but that's pretty good. let's get to, I believe they play Lee on Friday, so expect them to probably get to 5-0. Then they have Madison, Johnson, Churchill. 2 weeks, that matchup against Johnson is going to be electric.
Yeah, we're building ourselves toward that Stone Oak Super Bowl a little bit,
yeah.
And that's the big one that everybody's going to be circling, and that's always such a good game. It was a good one last year. You know, those two are on a collision course, so that's the big game of the week that we're all kind of waiting for.
Yeah, that's going to be a hell of a matchup between them. It's the two teams at the top of our TNL top 10. I mean, mm-hmm. And it looks like they're probably going to get there as well. I mean, Johnson has Brandeis this week. They're number two in our TNL top 10. They went for 722 yards last week against an undefeated Roosevelt team. 56-20, they beat them. Ty Hawkins, 382 yards, three passing touchdowns, 92 yards on the ground, three rushing touchdowns. Dude just went off.
Yeah, I was at that game for the start of it at least, and it was a track meet at first because Roosevelt returned the kickoff. Their first kickoff time they got the hands on the ball, they returned it for a touchdown. So it was rapid fire a little bit at first, but that Johnson offense, when it's clicking and you know, they have guys. It starts with King Johnson, of course, Bubba Johnson in the backfield. They've got offensive weapons all over the field. So it's kind of just pick your poison when you play the Jaguars. It's who you try to take away, but then it's like, guess what? They've got two other playmakers that are just hard to stop, and some of their other receivers are making plays as well.
Yeah, I mean, there's the wagon on offense, and they don't stop. They don't stop coming at you. I mean, Ty Hawkins is making everyone aware of why he's going to TCU. I mean, it's ridiculous what he does. And that matchup in 2 weeks, Johnson and Reagan is going to be, I might need to watch the film a couple of times on that one. That's going to be crazy. Usually when Jack brings back his footage, we look for the scoring plays. I might just watch that whole game.
Yeah. No, we'll definitely have him set up for that one to hopefully maybe take that one in. So
yeah, exactly. I know that the coaches and players are going to be ecstatic either or after that game, no matter who wins. So Steele is number three. There's really not a lot of changes in the top eight here in the TNL top 10. Steele still number three. They're 4-1. They're on a bye week this week. They beat Birmingham out of California 49-7. Chad Warner threw for three touchdowns, 167. They're absolutely rolling right now. I mean, they're rolling right into the bye week, getting ready for district play.
Yeah, and they've got, you know, it's that weird district where there's only, you know, 5-6 teams, and San Marcos being ineligible to reach the playoffs. So it's, you know, they're almost guaranteed to have a playoff spot. It's just, how do they keep things on point, not get distracted, not lose focus, and keep things trending the right way? And Coach Sines is going to obviously keep those guys on task to do that, because they're playing great football right now. The Lake Travis game, obviously one that they would have liked to have performed better in, but I think they learned some lessons there, and they're obviously applying them because, yeah, you said it, they're rolling. They've won three straight in a row, and you look for that trend to continue.
Yeah, and they're just trashing teams right now. They're not even close. I mean, and they're playing good teams like Midland Legacy. I mean, they're playing Birmingham out of California, who is traditionally a good program. I know not a lot of us know about them right now. That school is literally like 15 minutes up the road from where my sister lives in California. So kind of familiar with them, but they're just rolling, absolutely. Harlan is fourth. They are 5-0, 3-0 in district. They defeated Warren, which was extremely impressive, knowing that how good that Warren team is, too. They're a highly competitive team with Tony Meza, and they held them to under 150 yards.
Yeah, the Hawks, you know, I got to that one just before halftime, and they took a 24-7 lead going into the break. And to put the clamps down on a Warren team who, you know, can put some points on the board, and they're always competitive, That's really impressive. So, Eddie Salas, man, he's got that team playing at a high level right now. So, the Harlan Hawks, that'll be an interesting team to watch. As we mentioned, we talked about that district before. Can they, you know, really make a push down the stretch here to kind of end out on top?
Right. They play Stevens on Saturday at Gus. That should be a nice competitive game. See if they can hold the Falcons to under 150 yards like they did. They also had 446 yards of offense. I mean, the team is absolutely on fire to start the year halfway through the season, looking to get that district win. So, Smithson Valley, they beat Canyon 42-21. They are 4-1, 2-0 in district. Next game, they got a bye week this week, so they're off. Alamo Heights, 5-0. They are sixth on our TNL top 10. They are 5-0, 4-0 in district. Burbank got that win against Burbank 55-20. They are also on a bye. Like we said, a lot of teams on bye this week. Jay is 5-0, 3-0 in district. They are number 7 on the TNL top 10. They beat Stevens 21-14. Kind of talked about them a little bit already. They play Sotomayor on Thursday at 7 o'clock. And then, speaking of Soto, they're 8th on our TNL top 10. They're 4-0, 2-0 in district. They beat Holmes 39-7, allowing their first points of the season. What do you think we're going to see tomorrow night when they play in Gus, 7 o'clock?
So, Jay...
Two undefeated teams.
Excuse me, Sotomayor, you know, they stopped a good Holmes team, which can run the ball. The Huskies did get a score. That was on a passing play, and that's, you know, kind of knocked out that whole thing where they haven't allowed a point the whole season, the Wildcats that we're speaking of. can the Wildcats stop a really good rushing attack, a kind of a two-headed monster for John Jay? John Jay has things rolling too. You know, they're playing with a lot of confidence right now. So that's going to be, I think, you know, a fist fight in that game. So we'll be out at that one. So that one will be interesting to see how that one plays out. It's going to be a really, I'm expecting a close game.
A lot of rushing yards in that matchup. Two highly powered rushing offenses.
And that's where I'm really interested to see, you know, how good is this Wildcats defense? Can they play discipline? Because Jay, they can do some different things, some creative things of trying to get their, you know, playmakers the ball and stuff. They've got a receiver that made some plays last week. So Jay doesn't throw the ball much, but you know it's almost kind of like an Army thing where it's like they just ground and pound you, and then they flip it outside real quick, and then all of a sudden you know you're out of position or over pursuing,
right?
And then they're breaking off big gains.
Yeah, you have to stay in your gaps. You have to have gap discipline if you're gonna play the Jay Mustangs. Same with Soto, though. I mean, you got to have gap discipline there. Jaden Gutierrez is a hell of a running back. So, I mean, they're going to have all things clicking. We know that Juan Morales is going to have them ready to roll come Thursday night. And they always play on Thursday night. It seems like Juan likes to play on those Thursdays. let's get to number nine. We mentioned Tyvee. They beat Liberty Hill this week, 34-28. They're 5-0, 1-0 in district. They're a new addition to the TNL Top 10. As we had a couple of teams late in the top 10 that lost last week, including Warren. Their next game is at Bastrop on Friday at 7 o'clock. Last time Tyvee won was 2018. That game was 63-62 in overtime. So shootout going on in Bastrop last time that these two, last time Tyvee won.
Yeah, and obviously new kids on the rosters now. So, you know, you kind of look at that. Sure, the series history favors Bastrop and everything, but Bastrop 3-2 on the season so far. So again, this is a good road test for Tyvee, and just can they keep things going? And as we mentioned, we're getting into that middle part of the season where it's just okay. Are we maybe feeling ourselves too much? Can we stay on focus? Can we stay on task? And push things over the finish line here to get where we want to go.
Yeah, you know what happens when the teams fill themselves too much. Just look at what happened to the Cowboys this past weekend. So then number 10 to close it out, we got the Bernie Champion Chargers. Still undefeated, 5-0, 2-0 in district. Bernie Champion won 40-21 last week. They remain undefeated under first-year head coach, even though he's been there a while as a defensive coordinator and whatnot. But Blaine Ellis having a heck of a first year. They're also on a bye this week.
Yeah, just, I don't know. I feel like the beat goes on for Bernie, both programs up there, Bernie and Bernie Champion. It's just, there's always competitive teams up there where it's just, it seems like they reload. They don't rebuild, they just reload. And it's somehow they have playmakers all over in these new classes coming up and everything. So Bernie Champion, they, you know, I'm drawing a blank on their district at the moment here, but they'll be, it's been a great start to the season. So now it's just like, okay, now it's, can you make that final end game here where it's like, you know, are they for real? Or is it just, you know, was it kind of just a hot start and things are rolling good now?
Yeah. I mean, teams will look at their first half, and that's always good to have kind of like that bye week right after week five, just because you can evaluate, okay, what did we do in the first
kind of
5 weeks?
Take a break. Yeah.
Take a break, take a breather, look at what you did well the first 5 weeks, do a little self-scouting and find out what you need to do over the next 5 weeks to keep that undefeated streak rolling. So let's get to the sub-TNL top 10. 1-10 looks like this. Not a lot of changes. Cuero, 5-0. They are 1. Bernie is number 2 at 4-1. Jerdenton, number 3 at 5-0. Lavernia, number 4 at 4-1. Somerset, number 5 at 3-1. Randolph, 6 at 5-0. Hondo, 7 at 5-0. 8, Bandera at 4-1. 9, Ingram, 4-0. And Poth pulls off that 10-7 victory. They are 4-1 as well. They're number 10. So let's get to our TNL game of the week. Brennan, 2-2, coming off a bye, 1-1 in district. O'Connor, 0-5, 0-3 in district, coming off a loss, probably their worst loss of the season to Taft, 34-0. What do you think we're going to see tomorrow night on the TNL top 10 or TNL matchup? Because I mean, these teams, it's always a dogfight when they get in the when they get on the field.
You touched on it right there. It's the records may not, you know, have this as a big matchup of the week, but no, these teams are going to come out and they're going to play some hard-nosed football and everything. Coach Baser, you know, it's obviously a younger squad, lots of turnover from the year before, missing out on the DuBose brothers and all those playmakers, but he's been finding some guys, right? You know, it's they've kind of opened some eyes here a little bit that, hey, you know, they could be, you know, next year they could be a team to watch, because if, you know, just one more year of experience being in the system, they're going to be really good. Now, of course, everybody's going to be like, oh, well, Brennan, 3-2, they're the better team. Well, yeah, it's maybe not been the start of the season that Coach Molesky and the O'Connor Panthers have been a team that had playoff aspirations. They could still get there. I know at the start of the season there were just some things that it just didn't look like a coach – it was uncharacteristic of the Coach Molesky team. Just, you know, they had some false starts, just little things, you know, self-inflicted wounds that came from some of their leaders that I think really kind of hurt them. But, you know, hey, all it takes is one win and they can really, the Panthers could rip some things off here.
Yeah, it tells you the attitude of the team, because I was talking to Coach Molesky a little earlier and I was like, obviously it's a down year for you guys, but what is your attitude going into the back half of the season? He's like, we can still make the playoffs.
Exactly.
Like, what are you talking about?
The door's not shut yet.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the attitude of Coach Molesky. Like, whenever you talk to anybody, it's like they're going to be detailed, they're going to be hard-nosed, they're going to come to play, and they're not going to end until the final whistle. So, I mean, it tells you everything you need to know when you hear from Coach Molesky here in a couple of minutes that they're not done with this season yet, even though they're 0-5.
Yeah, and you will expect Coach Molesky to take away Brennan's running back, Love, because he's a guy that can, you know, really hurt you. So look for them to key in on him and try and take him away a little bit. So I'm expecting, you know, it should be a really close game.
Yeah, and O'Connor's got some players, man. I mean, Briley Brown, he's an offensive defensive lineman. He's committed to UTSA. I mean, they got some dudes. Yeah. On that team, and Coach Molesky and Coach Baser know each other very well.
Yes.
And they've been playing against each other for a long time. So, I mean, they know exactly what to expect out of that game. So, let's hear from Coach Molesky, Coach Baser right now, and then we'll come up and wrap it up right afterwards.
Well, it's a pleasure to have Coach Molesky. Coach, how are you today, besides all the technical issues?
Doing well. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, we're excited to have you back on TNL. We had you last year, have you this year as well. Going into the matchup with Brennan, I mean, you kind of know it's always going to be a dogfight. What are you guys looking forward to tomorrow?
Just what you said. It's going to be a dogfight. We've had some really incredible games over the years with those guys.
When it comes to facing off against Coach Baser, what does that kind of entail? What do you know you're going to get when you take on a Coach Baser coached team?
Well, the first thing that always jumps out at you is they're a real physical football team. I mean, across the board, from the front, the big guys up front to the skill positions, offensively and defensively, they're always really physical. And they're a really athletic football team. And so that in itself presents challenges for you.
When it comes to the differences between, like, you know, facing them last year and facing them this year, obviously two very different teams going to be squaring off on TNL this year as opposed to when you guys played last year. So is there some similarities you kind of take with you, or what can you kind of hold over when it comes to game planning for these guys?
Well, when you've been coaching as long as I have and Coach Baser, there are going to be some things that you're going to hang your hat on, and that's no different at any level of football. And there's going to be there's a theme for every football team in terms of how they're doing things offensively, defensively. And that hasn't changed. You know, the players change every year, teams change every year. But in terms of the philosophy of the program, both theirs and ours, that's no different. And so there's things that we know that they're going to do, and there's things that they know we're going to do. And so you go out and adapt the kids that you have each year to your philosophy and trying to make those things happen.
Whenever you ask somebody what is it like to play an O'Connor Panther team? You hear like three key words. You hear they're going to be disciplined, you hear they're going to have detail, and you know they're going to be tough, hard-nosed kids, and they're going to try. Well, how much pride do you take in that?
Well, there's a lot of things in this game that we can't control. And we feel like, and I ask this of our kids all the time, and not only ask, but we demand it out of them, that we're going to play with total effort and we're going to play with class. And those are two things that regardless of ability, regardless of records, regardless of past, present, or future, you have 100% control on that. And so that's really important to us. And then the third aspect of that is that, yes, execution is really important. And we talk to our kids all the time about nearly right or exactly right. And we don't want to just be close. We don't want to be almost there. We want to get things exactly right. And so if we're in an off-season drill, if we're in practice preparing for a game, if we're not doing something right, we're going to do it over again until we do get it right. And it's so that we can play on Friday night with minimal mistakes in the execution aspect of it.
Coach, obviously we're five games in, a little bit of a down year by your standards and O'Connor's standards. What is the attitude of this team as you go into the last five games of the season, and what are your expectations?
Well, the first attitude right now is we're still in the middle of a playoff hunt. I mean, there's still a lot of football left, and I've been in this district for a lot of years, and I've seen crazy things happen. And, you know, I drove by the stadium the other day, and there's still a scoreboard there. And our thoughts that if there's a scoreboard there, we're going to play the game to win the game. And so, you know, each week is a new week. Each week is a different week. Yeah, we haven't – the first five didn't go the way that we wanted to, you know, and there's a lot of reasons for that. But it's kind of irrelevant in terms of what's going to happen tomorrow night. And so we try to do things a certain way. We have a routine in terms of how we practice, but we also have a routine in terms of our expectations of a program. And that's that we're going to run every race to win. And as long as there's a scoreboard, we're going to prepare. Our coaching staff's going to prepare on the weekend. Like we've won 15 games already. It's kind of, I hate to say it's a routine because that be monotonous, but it's also important though, because we feel like that's created some of the success that we've had over the years.
Coach, if tomorrow night when I'm handing you guys the TNL trophy and all that stuff, and I ask you, why did you win tonight? What will your answer be? Like, what is the most important reason that you will have won that game?
The first two things is that I mentioned, that we're going to go out there and we're going to play 48 minutes or more of football, and that we're going to minimize mistakes. I mean, they are a football team that as athletic as they are, that can really magnify a mistake. And so it's really important that we minimize those. Turnovers are going to be something that's critical. I mean, we have not fared well here in the last few weeks in terms of turnover margin. We need to get that flipped in our favor, and that will help. Winning the kicking game. I've always been a huge proponent about the kicking game and stressing that and trying to make plays in the course of ball games in the kicking game. And then, you know, just, as I said, playing for 48 minutes.
Coach, I asked Coach Baser this as well. The depth of the district that you guys play in is it's kind of expanded over the last few years. It seems like every year there's another team that is getting better and better and kind of putting their name into the hat for district champ. What's that like for you, knowing that your district only gets better and better as the year goes on and as the seasons go on?
Well, it's actually I've known this a lot longer than a lot of people, that in our district, in this Northside district, you better, regardless of records, you better show up and be ready to be at your best. Because I've seen a lot of upsets over the years, and I've seen a lot of teams that have come from nowhere and become something. And so, you know, that's what's kind of neat about us is we are a district, and there's nine of us in this district, and there's a couple, you know, in another district. And so you're right. I mean, there's every year there's going to be somebody that can make a deep playoff run, if it's not a couple people that can do that. And so, you know, that I think that gives some merit to our district, because we kind of at times I feel like we're the second sister, and you know, to some other places. And so I'm proud of our district. I'm proud of the success that our district has beyond the district play. But I also know too that week in and week out, you better be ready to be at your best, or it's going to be a long night for you.
And Coach, I love doing this when I get you guys onto these Zooms with coaches. Can you give me maybe two or three players, offense and defense, of guys who are just, you know, they exemplify O'Connor football, great on and off the field? Who are those guys? Who are those captains for you that you kind of hang your hat on as O'Connor guys?
Well, starting off on the offensive side of the football, Briley Brown. He's going to be a 3-year starter in the offensive line. He's committed to UTSA. He's had three brothers that have played offensive line here at O'Connor. They all play Division I football as well. But Briley's a great young man, and he hasn't gotten to where he was just because of his genes. He's a hard worker, and he was elected by his teammates as one of our leadership council people. Another one, Ryder Dorn. Ryder's our quarterback this year, and Ryder was elected as well. He started the last 2 years at cornerback, and then this year he started in the offseason at quarterback, and he ended up winning that job. And he's done really, really well for somebody who hadn't played quarterback since he was a freshman. And then on the defensive side of the football, Nicholas Chapa is a 2-year starter at safety for us that was elected too, that has played a lot of games, and he's a very vocal player for us defensively. So those are three guys right there that jump out at me and we're proud of. I mean, they exemplify in terms of playing with the effort that we want and playing the right way and not just being a great kid on the field, but they're also great kids off the field as well.
And Coach, I remember you guys were playing in the Alamo Dome week one, and Ryder caught the snap and then fumbled the snap and then moved around, threw the touchdown pass downfield. I was like, oh my God, what a play.
Right.
He can move, man. He can get that ball downfield.
You know, if you looked at him and you said, what kind of athlete he's in terms of measurables, you know, he's not the fastest, the strongest, the tallest or anything, but he's a competitor. And, you know, being a competitor outweighs a lot of stats that, you know, are widely published. And I'm going to take a kid that is going to do everything he can, that's going to fight to win every day over a kid that's just maybe has a you know, the measurables being better. But because, you know, once again, it goes back to something I said to you earlier, that, you know, we control our effort. We control our competitiveness. It doesn't have anything to do with, you know, your size or where you came from or anything. It's about what's inside of you. And to me, that's the most important thing. And that's also too, high school athletics. There's still a place for that kid that's got a big heart. That can shine and have success regardless of all the other things.
I couldn't agree with you more. That's why I love high school athletics. It's a place where boys turn into men, and right. you guys as coaches play a pivotal role in that. So it's awesome to see. I wanted to ask you, every time I go to an O'Connor game to film or get highlights or whatever, I always notice how many people are in the stands, and you guys have built in your time there a great community and a great following and support from the people around you. Can you just tell me a little bit about what it's like having that kind of support and what it's like for you to have kind of built that over at O'Connor?
Well, I'm going to disagree with you on something. I haven't built that. We've built that. And I mean that sincerely, that it's not just one. Yeah, there's a football team playing, but there's so many other organizations that are there that are being highlighted in their community, that, you know, from the band community to the spirit cheerleader community, ROTC has a big role in it. And then the student body, I mean, they feel a certain expectation about their involvement in it, and they want to be a part of that. And just over the years, that has grown, and you know, we have people, and I hear it all the time because I live in this community, and you know, I'm walking by and somebody says, hey coach, how's it going? And I have no idea who they are, but come to find out, there's somebody that comes to the games. They have nobody in high school anymore, but they still want to come to the games, and you know, I know how special that is. I've been here for so long. I've been here over 20 years. And these kids, you know, when they leave and come back 4 or 5 years later and they're really young men at this point, you know, they recognize too that, wow, that was pretty special.
Yeah, and like that's another reason I love high school football. There's nothing like a Friday night or Thursday night in a high school football stadium, and especially in a game between O'Connor and Brennan. You throw the records out the window, and you just see some great high school football on the field.
Right, I agree.
Well, Coach, that's all I got for you. I appreciate you taking some time battling through the technical issues for me and
right
and giving me a few minutes.
You bet.
We'll
look forward to tomorrow night.
Yep, we'll see you tomorrow night. I'll come chat with you before the game. So good luck, okay. And we'll see you tomorrow.
You bet.
Well, Coach, thanks so much again for joining us here. Pleasure to have you guys on TNL once again this season.
Yeah, we're excited, you know, to be back on. And I think we were on 2 or 3 weeks ago, and here we go again. But always exciting to be on TNL.
I mean, it was an exciting one last time with Harlan. I wasn't able to talk to you after the game. You guys – Harlan came back on you. Yeah, how's the team been, and how was the bye week for you guys to try and get your feet under you?
Well, you know, we played Taft, you know, after that game, and so we got our first, you know, district win, and we're 1-1 right now. And the off week really helped because we had a few guys get injured in the summer, and so they either played sparingly or not much. And then we finally got a guy back, and then a couple guys back from injury now. So that should help us out going into, you know, this week and the rest of district. So the bye week came, you know, at a good time. Ideally it actually would have come earlier, but you know, I think we're back to healthy on both sides of the ball now, and that should really help us out moving forward. So we're excited about that.
Coach, you guys have such a young team. How has that, the first four games that you have and then the bye week, how does that kind of help you guys get ready for the last six games, which are all district games pretty much for you?
Well, I mean, you know, regardless of your, you know, experience and veteran team or new and young, whatever the case, you know, it always has to be a week by week process. And, you know, so we're trying to just stick to, you know, what matters this week. You know, you've seen the acronym WIN, what's important now. And that's kind of where we're focused. What's important now? Well, we play O'Connor this week, so that's what's important now. So we got to focus 100% on, you know, O'Connor and study them and get our game plan, learn our game plan. You know, Thursday games kind of create a short week. When normally you would have Fridays, so you kind of get an extra day to, you know, practice your game plan and implement your game plan and learn, you know, your opponent. Well, on a Thursday game, you get one less day to do that. So it makes it challenging, you know, for both of us, O'Connor and ourselves, to kind of speed up that process. You know, when you're a veteran team, it doesn't affect you as much. When you're a younger team, it probably affects you a little more. So we're squeaking in every minute to try to, you know, make sure that we understand what's going on. Everybody knows their job, do their job, so on and so forth. And, you know, we had a pretty good practice week. And at this point, you know, we play the game tomorrow. So hopefully they understand what's got to be done and can execute at a high level. And that's what we're shooting for. Usually in these circumstances, we try to keep it a little easier just to have less to learn in a shorter week. But again, that's the challenge with Thursday games and the exciting part of it, because it always can create exciting situations. And I say that, you know, it can be exciting in a good way and a bad way. So we'll see tomorrow night.
You never know. I don't want you to, you know, open up the game plan book for me or anything, but what is kind of some keys to victory for tomorrow for you guys on TNL?
Well, you know, like you said, with a younger type team, it's really handling our business. So number one is executed at a high level. Number two is really controlling mistakes. You know, I really try to emphasize to our team, you know, every year, mistakes are what beat you. It's rarely the other team is that much better. It's often we you know, didn't fit right, or, you know, we didn't key right, or we blew a coverage or whatever. And if you just eliminate mistakes and turnovers being a part of that, I mean, those three things really dictate your game. You can't control your opponent. You can control you. So back to execute your game plan, eliminate mistakes by knowing your job, doing your job, and then controlling turnovers. And I think if we do that, we're good, you know, we're the best we can possibly be any week. And I think if we do that, our chances of winning are very high. And so that's what our really focus is in those three areas. So I'd say those are definitely the keys, because at the end of the day, if we're not executing, that's a bad sign. If we're making mistakes, that's a bad sign. If we're turning the ball over, that's a bad sign. And those three things get you beat. And everybody knows the turnover deal, you know, and that's, you know, highly politicized, but again, at the end of the day, it's execution and mistakes. So we got to execute at a very high level, and we got to minimize mistakes. And if we can do those things, control turnovers, we should be all right.
You guys got Coach Molesky and the O'Connor Panthers coming up. I mean, Coach Molesky, you know what you're going to get in an O'Connor team with him at the helm, right?
Definitely, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, they're always going to play hard. They're always going to do, you know, what the coach would do and do it at a high standard and high level, kind of like I was just talking about we're trying to do this week. And I've told the kids that, like these guys are going to play as hard as anybody plays. Their kids fly around on offense, fly around on defense, fly around on special teams. They do a really good job in special teams. So that's another thing we got to really be on top of, because I think they blocked a couple kicks this year, earlier in the year, which is a big deal. And they've had some big returns in the kickoff return game and so on and so forth. So we got to be on top of our, you know, special teams game and all the different phases of that, as well as be on top of offense and defense. So, and again, you know, great coaches over there, Coach Molesky, Coach Hooper, you know, I've known those guys for a long time and they do a really good job. And so it's going to be a big challenge for our team and we're looking forward to it. But, you know, we definitely understand that O'Connor can, you know, rise up and beat anybody on any given day, just like any opponent can. And those guys are going to play hard and they've got a lot of pride, a lot of tradition, and we got to be ready for them tomorrow night.
And Coach, you guys have six games left on the district slate. You guys still have two of the teams that are above you in the standings right now with Jay and Sotomayor, two out of the last 3 weeks of the season. How motivating is that for you guys and your team saying, you know, we kind of have everything in front of us as long as maybe Harlan slips up a little bit for that district title?
Right. I mean, you know, it's not exciting to be in a situation where you don't necessarily control your own destiny as far as district championship goes. But, you know, obviously we're in the hole, and I tell the kids, you know, when district starts, there's going to be four teams on top of the mountain. Those are the guys that win, and four teams at the bottom of the mountain. Those are the guys that lose. And we were that losing group by losing to Harlan. So now we have to climb the mountain. Right. And we got to take it one step at a time. We have seven more games. We got to control what we can control. And that's hopefully, again, what's important now, beat O'Connor. What's important next week, you know, next week's game, so on and so forth. If we go 1-0 for the rest of the season, the worst we can do is 6-7-1 at district. And then if Harlan, you know, slips up or somebody sneaks up on them, then maybe you get tri-champs or you know, something else crazy happens. But at the end of the day, we're just trying to focus on winning every game, finishing as strong as possible, and then hopefully, you know, qualifying for playoffs, making the playoffs, so on and so forth. You know, if we make it and Taft makes it, we're the two big teams. And so us beating them last week kind of helped us out from, if it's us and Taft and Harlan and someone else, then, you know, we would have the top seed in the big bracket. So you're not district champs, but you still get the top seed in your bracket. So, you know, that's a super positive in the scenario. And obviously being a district champ is always more fun than not being a district champ. But at the end of the day, we still can be the number one seed and you know, set ourselves up in the playoffs. But to do that, we got to beat O'Connor, you know, tomorrow night, and then we got to beat everybody else along the way. But again, we're focused one game at a time.
Coach, can you just tell me a little bit how the depth of your guys' district is kind of crazy. Soto, obviously, has only allowed 7 points in four games. Jay is much improved this season, still undefeated. Warren, still a good team with Tony Meza, quarterback. I mean, obviously, Harlan, a good team. You guys, Taft. I mean, all of these teams in this district. Can you just tell me a little bit about the depth of that and how that prepares you for the postseason?
Well, I, you know, it's been a thing of late, and I think that's true because, you know, there have been a few coaching changes along the way, but there's a lot of good coaching in the district, and there's a lot of good teams. You know, and like you said, right now, there's probably, you know, six – maybe seven teams that have a chance to make the playoffs. And, you know, some teams have done themselves a huge favor. You know, all the teams that are undefeated right now, you know, Sotomayor, Harlan, and Jay, you know, are really sitting pretty. And the rest of us are trying to work our way back up. And us, you know, having a bye week in a way puts us behind because everybody else has a game. So we're in, like, kind of catch-up mode, and we're trying to get wins. Like I said, trying to go 7-1. And right now we're 1-1. So still six games to go and a lot of that mountain to climb. But, you know, that's what kind of makes it fun. I mean, you know, sometimes when you're on top and you know, where we've been sometimes in the past, you don't enjoy it as much. But this is going to be a climb from the bottom of the mountain to the top of the mountain, hopefully. And that's what we're trying to do. And that makes the journey and the adventure that much more exciting and makes every game that much more competitive and that much more important. So I really think it can grow a young team because it does have to be a step-by-step process. And as much as you want to fast forward it and make us as good as we can be, we can only be as good as we are, you know, at this moment, you know, tomorrow night, so on and so forth. And our growth is just based on our you know, learning process and getting comfortable, you know, at the varsity level, so on and so forth. Again, we're halfway into the season, so hopefully things have settled in. Again, we're healthier, or as healthy as we've been all year, which is, you know, super beneficial. And so hopefully those positives are going to carry over and then, you know, create a snowball effect. So we've got our first win, so we got a little snowball. And now we're going to hopefully get our second. Now it's going to get a little bigger and try to make it, you know, really big at the end and finish with a bang. And if that gets us tied, you know, for the district championship in some way, great. If that keeps us at the top seed in the big bracket, that, you know, at the end of the day, that's the most important thing in terms of postseason play. And so that's, we're glad that we were, you know, semi able to secure that again, assuming, and that's a big assumption because of the depth, like you mentioned, that us and Taft get in. Cause you know, right now it's kind of crazy because a lot of teams get in. So I mean, every game is important, you know, for all the teams and, you know, every week you start guessing, well, are they going to beat them and they're going to do that? And that, but I don't think anything is for a foregone conclusion this year. Cause I think it is so competitive. And I do think Harlan is you know, arguably the best team in the district, you know, right now. And the ball's in their court cause they took care of business against us and so on and so forth. So, all things being equal, we're right now we're focused on getting that top seed, trying to finish second. And if somehow, you know, Harlan slips up along the way, that's, you know, not in our control. So we're not really focused on that. It's just a matter of handling our business, doing what we got to do to be successful.
But you guys have a really different team than you did last year and the year before that. It's very young, obviously. How does that present a different challenge to you and your coaching staff as opposed to maybe last year, the year before when you had the DeBose brothers and you had all those weapons and whatnot? What kind of year does this give you and when it comes to coaching that team?
Well, a lot more coaching. I mean, you know, I mean, seriously, you know, I mean, you coach all the time, but wow, you got to coach young kids a lot and you got to coach inexperienced guys a lot. And we've got a lot of young kids and we got, you know, a fair amount of inexperience. So every coach really has to make sure they're dotting their I's and crossing their T's about, you know, their individual you know, positions and then the units, whether it's the D line or the O line or the receivers or the linebackers or whatever. And then, you know, the units themselves, offense, defense, special teams. And then back to everything I mentioned before with executing at a high level, no mistakes, so on and so forth, and controlling turnovers. But, you know, hopefully we're able to do that. And again, that usually creates success, you know, in the game and doing those things. But, you know, when it, say, for example, the DeBose twins and that crew of seniors, you know, last year, which was a really good group, and a lot of them were offensive. But, you know, when they were sophomores, we had a pretty dominant defense. So we struggled a little bit on offense, but it didn't go as noticed because we were really good on defense, you know. And then like last year's team, we were very good on offense and we were pretty good on defense, right? So the defense could kind of thrive a little bit off the offense's, you know, dominance. Well, we're not dominant right now on either side. So what makes this year unique for us is we're not dominant on either side of the ball when usually it's one or two. And with it being not dominant on either, that means we're scrapping and fighting on offense, we're scrapping and fighting on defense, we're scrapping and fighting on special teams. So again, that creates an environment of a lot of coaching, a lot of learning, a lot of coachability on the kids' part, and then them again turning it into no mistakes, high execution level, no turnovers, and playing, you know, the winning recipe for football, which is basically that. And so that's what we're focused on doing and just trying to get the kids to understand that none of this is foregone conclusion about who's finishing where, what seeds are what. At the end of the day, we've got one loss, one win. We need to get six more wins, one at a time. O'Connor, this week, here we go.
All right, Coach. Well, I appreciate the time today. And I mean, I can't wait to see you guys. I love having you guys on TNL. You guys always show out, especially with the community, the band, and the boosters. Everybody always shows out, so it's always great.
Yeah, I mean, we've got a great school and a lot of extracurriculars. And again, you guys highlight all the great things that happen in high school football, you know, be it band, cheer, spirit, you know, ROTC, football, et cetera, sports in general. And it's just great to give the kids that opportunity and the schools and the communities that opportunity. So we're very appreciative of being on the program, and hopefully we'll give you something to see tomorrow night.
I mean, you gave us a great game last time. Hopefully you give us another one.
Yeah, I love great games as long as, you know,
you're on top. Great game last week. All right, Coach. Well, I appreciate it. I'm sure you have a lot to do, so I'll talk to you tomorrow.
All right. Sounds good, man. Appreciate you.
All right. Love hearing from those two coaches. It's going to be a great matchup on TNL. I can't wait.
Looking forward to it.
That's all we got for today on this edition of High School Hype Squad here on Sneakers and Cleats Podcast. David Chancellor and I be back on Friday, break down the upcoming week of football as the Cowboys try and get back on track after that disastrous game on Sunday.
You know, yeah, I know everybody wants to call it it. Yeah, not a great loss. Stub your toe on a team that starts out 0-2, but Cowboys fans, I think, can breathe a little bit. They need to, you know, take a chill pill, because if they correct some things and move to 3-1, all's right with the world. So
only thing that matters is week 5 right now, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I mean, of course, that's going to be a real good measuring stick to see where they are, you know, and how that Dan Quinn defense plays against an offense that has a bunch of weapons.
Absolutely. And we will also talk a little bit about Taylor Swift, whether David wants to or not, because I think that's like you have to at this point. You just have to talk about what the hell is going on in Kansas City.
I mean, so even Micah Parsons was chiming in on it. And
even Bill Belichick was chiming in on it.
He had a great line too, and I loved that Andy Reid was, you know, well, hey, I set them up. You know, yeah, so.
did you hear? Did you hear Travis on New Heights this morning?
No,
he was like, that's a big old Cupid, man. So we'll talk about that. We also have our first guest of the season, Jerome Bettis, the Bus. Going to be joining us on the SAC pod. I just recorded that a couple of minutes ago. Going to get that all edited up for everybody. So that'll be a nice treat. He comments on the status of the running backs in the NFL, what it's like for a running back like Zeke to go play his old team. So a lot of good things from the Bus on that one. So
Steeler in Cowboys country.
Well, quick reminder, you get this podcast wherever you get your podcast and on YouTube. The YouTube version has video elements like The Bus, who will be on here on Friday. We got some video plugged in along the way as well. Please download, subscribe, rate, review, unsubscribe, even though I have pun subscribe written down. I don't know why. A little typo. Resubscribe, re-rate, re-review, give us a 5-star rating, give us some feedback. Feedback is a gift. We'll see you right here on Friday, here on Sneakers and Cleats Podcast.